White Rabbit presents Oh Yes, Oh Yes, written by Carl Cox with Alon Shulman, read by Hugh Quarshie. Foreword by Laurent Garnier. It is a real honor to be writing here about one of the greatest people I have ever met. We all know and love Carl as a king of the dance floor, and watching him in action is such a joy. But Carl Cox is so much more than just an amazing DJ. He's a truly wonderful person. You couldn't ask for a more thoughtful and caring friend, and our friendship has been there from day one. I first met Carl in New York in the very early 1990s, and I instantly felt like I'd known him for years. We were at the New Music Seminar in New York, and like everyone who meets Carl, I was instantly drawn to his personality. I'd seen him from a distance at some raves in the UK, but had never spoken to him. What struck me was his immense passion for the music that I loved and his belief in what we were all trying to do. These were the early days of the scene, and none of us knew if it would or could last. But Carl was all about the music, and scene or no scene, I could see that would never change. I flew him straight over to the Rex in Paris, and could see that he instantly bonded with the crowd without fully understanding how mesmerized we all were watching him play. No matter how big he's become as a DJ, he has remained true to his original pioneering underground spirit. Carl is not like most underground DJs. He can play anything to anyone, anywhere, and make something special happen. He is the most energetic person I know, and he puts a lot of this energy into his music. When you know Carl's personality, it all makes sense. Like with everything he does, when he plays, he gets straight to the point. His positive and open-minded attitude comes through in the music, and it's like he's glowing with his own visible aura. In fact, glowing is a good way to think of Carl, because it's like he's surrounded by an energy force that fills every room he's in and helps light the way forward. Even when he's concentrating, it seems like he's always smiling. His big smile is famous, and it makes you smile too. Anyone who can make you smile and make you dance has got to be doing something right. Everybody loves Carl, and Carl loves everybody. He doesn't have a dark side. He's always upbeat, even in his hardest times, and that's what makes him so special. His positivity is out of this world. Carl has proved to everybody that it is possible to really be something if you believe in yourself. When you look at where he came from and how high he climbed so quickly, it became an inspiration to many of us and an example to hundreds of thousands of people. Like when Daft Punk influenced a whole generation of French music makers after they seemed to go straight to the top from day one to the next, but Carl did this first. He has shown people that they too can achieve, partly because he makes everything look so simple. He made the scene accessible, always shaking hands with everyone and saying hi or giving out hugs and spreading his happy vibes. We were both playing at a big rave in Scotland where there were about 15,000 people and a massive queue to get in. I was with Carl, and as we walked down the side of the line, everyone seemed to be calling out his name and trying to shake his hand. He acknowledged them all individually, and I remember thinking, wow, I'd never imagined us DJs could be famous. The first time he played for me in Paris, the crowd at the Rex went absolutely mental. He gave them that Carl Cox magic, and the whole club rocked. We have gone on to play together all over the world, often on the same lineups as Richie Horton and Jeff Mills, and have made many memories together. The Rex was the place I had my best memory with Carl, and the only time I saw him nervous to play. I'd invited him over for the Rex's 15th anniversary weekend, and as part of that, we decided to do a rave for kids on the Sunday afternoon. The kids were very little, probably aged from 4 to 8, and Carl was worried about what to play. It was the only time I ever gave him advice, which was, just be yourself. And he was. The more he banged it, the crazier the kids went. And when he played The Bells by Jeff Mills and Dave Clark's Red, they went absolutely wild. Little kids were rushing over to get a hug from Big Carl as he dropped some serious techno. Those kids are in their 20s now, and some have come up to me to tell me that the afternoon with Carl was one of the best experiences of their lives. Mine too. Carl is the biggest techno DJ ever and has become an icon who transcends the dance music scene. The aura surrounding him is even bigger than he is. People everywhere know his name, even if they haven't heard him play. All this is from his hard work, his limitless energy, and because everything he does, he shares with the scene. Carl taught me two things: respect each other, and if you believe in what you do, you can go all the way. Kindness, generosity, and positivity are three characteristics that sum up Carl for me. In all the years I have had the privilege of knowing him, he has never wavered from displaying these qualities. In France, we have a word when someone is totally selfless, and that is bienveillant. It isn't easy to translate, but it roughly means kind all the way round. That is Carl, the loveliest guy you could ever want to meet, someone committed to sharing the music he loves with everyone, an incredible human being, one who I'm proud to call my friend. Laurent Garnier, France, 2020. The King by Alon Shulman. Carl Cox, the three-deck wizard, is a living legend. Instrumental in the birth of the dance music scene and club culture, he continues to be at the forefront of the global dance music industry. He has music pumping through his veins and exudes an almost superhuman electrical energy wherever he goes. His whole mission is about spreading the joy that he gets from music to all of us. Once you've been to a Carl Cox gig and been initiated, there's no going back. You're hooked. For those of us lucky enough to work alongside Carl, be it on stage, in the studio, or at the track, it is clear why he generates so much admiration from his peers. His determination to succeed and to be the very best he can be is what drives him forward. But everything he does involves a deep consideration for the industry that he has helped to shape and that he loves so much. Hugely respected by artists and fans alike, Coxie never seems to slow down, continuing to push himself to greater heights. Few have been able to match the dedication and passion that Carl brings to his performances. His attitude, enthusiasm, and passion, coupled with his incredible feeling for music, is what makes him so special. The almost magical aura that surrounds him is what makes him the DJ's DJ. His technical mastery and musical selection puts him on a pedestal. But it is the way he openly shares his heart and soul with us that makes him unique. He really is the absolute greatest at what he does, and we love him for it. All hail the King! Nobody in dance music works harder than Carl Cox. He's always pushing himself to achieve more and more, and that's what's propelled him to global superstardom. His command of the dance floor is next level. Paul Oakenfold. Carl simply claims the stage by just being himself, a no-nonsense, uplifting spirit that lights up every room. Out of all the DJs out there, he has always been the one I look up to. Ferry Corsten. Carl Cox is the king of clubs and also the king of streams. He's a very dear friend and a mentor who for over 30 years has never ceased to inspire me. There are not enough words to describe this living legend. I love him to bits. Nicole Mudaba. After meeting Carl on so many occasions, he still makes you feel comfortable every single time and is genuinely interested in what people are doing and what they have to say. He has been a top professional now for over 30 years and is still an inspiration to many, including myself. He is the ultimate role model that every young DJ should aspire to be. What else can you say? There will never be another Carl. Adam Bayer. Carl is like the gold standard of DJing. For the 25 years or so I've watched him DJ, he has never faltered in his passion for quality music, dedication to his art, and endless work ethic. He has led the way and achieved everything there is to achieve, all while remaining truly humble. I didn't know Carl 30 plus years ago when he was starting out, but I imagine it's the same Carl you would meet today. He's the legend of legends. Jamie Jones. Carl Cox wrote the script of what it means to be a DJ. He's led the dance for decades and created a global underground movement that became the blueprint for the festivals and tours that followed for all of us. His innate sense of what makes people connect to music is a gift. But this isn't just a story of what he achieved, it's how. Carl's passion, determination, and imagination are just as legendary as his talent and the joie de vivre he brings to the party. It's a tale about being relentless against the odds, with a vision and a purpose. His story should inspire the next generation of DJs, party people, and music makers, and remind us of what we can create when we come together. David Guetta. Carl always had something special about him. He had that X factor. The memory that sticks out was when we were at a rave in Milton Keynes and all the lads were playing. Brian G, Carl, Jumping Jack Frost, Groove Rider, and me. There I was sitting down with Carl, listening to Groove Rider. Groove was killing it. Carl turned round to me and said, "I'm going to start playing techno. That's it for me." We were all playing hardcore jungle in the early days. I nudged him and said, "Why, are you crazy? I don't know one track Groove has played. I'm just not getting the tunes. I'm going to try something else," he replied. It was a brave move, one that I thought would be hard to pull off. The rest is history. No need to explain what happened next. Carl is the DJ's DJ. He has the passion, skill, and energy. I'm not surprised at all that he became one of the greatest of all time. On top of everything, he is such a warm and gentle person and deserves every bit of success that has come his way. Fabio. Carl has always been my favorite. He is the complete DJ, also the DJ's DJ. Records come to life when he plays them. Rooms come to life when he rocks them. His enthusiasm is infectious. His commitment, complete. Norman Cook, a.k.a. Fatboy Slim. From the early days of Rave, Stern's in Worthing, the Astoria, Club UK, The End, to him playing for us at our Shake It warehouse parties, and me for him at Space Ibiza, we have had a million magic moments together. Carl is one of the warmest, most generous, most charismatic people I have ever met. He is at the very top of his game, and always has been. His talent, drive, energy, and enthusiasm are next level. He is one of the most inspiring, positive, gifted DJs I have ever heard, and someone I regard as a legend, a mentor, and a really special friend for life. Matthew Benjamin, a.k.a. Bushwhacker. Carl Cox is one of the most genuine people I know. From the start, many years ago, he always greeted me with the warmest smile. You can feel he's a kind soul who just breathes music. He is an example to all of us and a great source of inspiration. Carl is a true legend. Charlotte DeWitt. Carl is a true inspiration to me as a DJ, but more importantly, as a man. He's my favorite DJ on the planet and has been since I first watched him play in 1995. He's always been the number one and will be until he hangs up his headphones, which I hope is a long way off. Long live Carl Cox. Eats everything. I first heard Carl DJ when I was 18 years old in a club in Streatham called Ziggy's. He was easily the most gifted DJ I'd heard from that era, and was also inspiring to me as a young black youth. Who would have known many years later I'd be sharing many a stage with him? I don't think there are many people who have actually inspired me in music and DJing like Carl. I can categorically say, if there wasn't a Carl Cox, there would never have been a Groove Rider. And to this day, I don't think he realizes the influence he has had on me and so many others. People use the term legend far too easily for my liking, but Carl is legend personified. Thank you, Carl. Groove Rider. The first time I ever heard a tune that I'd made played out in a club was January 1991 in Busby's, Astoria 2 in London. Me and the boys were having a night out. I suddenly heard everybody in the place being mixed in, and I was buzzing. So I made my way through the crowd to the DJ, and it was Carl playing it. I shook his hand and bounced off. That was a big moment for me, as I'd been to many raves in 89 and 90, standing in the crowd listening to him play, and him playing our tune gave it a stamp of authority from the underground. almost exactly the same thing happened when we were having another night out in London in 1996. I heard the Firestarter instrumental bang out the system. I made my way over to the decks, and it was Carl. Tunes being played on nights out partying always create those special moments that we never forget. I know Carl was responsible for a lot of mine. Carl has always supported the prodigy from the start, and I have nothing but love and the highest respect for him, not only for his mixing ability, 3 turntables, old school, I was there, tune-making ability, passion and energy, but also for being a top geezer. No sellout. Liam Howlett, the prodigy. Having Carl as a friend is a great privilege for me. Carl is an amazing human being, and his presence in my life makes everything better, in both artistic and personal ways. I owe him a lot for all the tips and advice he gave me throughout the years. He helped me grow and to improve myself in so many ways. I'm truly honored to be able to call him a close friend of mine. I will thank him forever for everything he has done and is still doing for me. Joseph Capriati. No matter how big he's become as a DJ, he has remained true to his original pioneering underground spirit. Carl is not like most underground DJs. He can play anything to anyone, anywhere, and make something special happen. Laurent Garnier. From the moment I first heard Carl as a teenager at Checkpoint Charlie in Reading in the 1990s, he has been a huge inspiration and influence to me. I am hugely grateful for the support he has given me as an artist and the belief he has shown in what I do. His diversity as a DJ shows his undying love for music, and his natural ability as a live artist is a testament to how extraordinarily talented he is. Absolute legend. Satek. Carl Cox is a timeless master DJ with a seemingly endless passion for music and DJing. I first became aware of Carl when he released I Want You, which quickly became my favorite track of that era. A few years later, Carl released the FACT album, which remains one of my favorite albums of all time. Carl's influence on the world of electronic dance music as a DJ, producer, and businessman cannot be overstated. He has blazed a trail for so many of us. His love for performing and genuine enthusiasm for his craft shines through on his smiling face and inspires joy in everyone around him. Tiesto. Not a lot of people know this, but when I was an underage DJ and playing in a wine bar in Sutton called Christie's, it was Carl Cox who used to take over for the final 30 minutes to give me time to get home and get up for school the next day. Carl has probably forgotten this, however, I haven't, and I've followed his incredible career ever since. Carl is one of the few true pioneers of UK club culture internationally. He has opened the door to so many DJs and inspired so many, including me. I have been honored to be invited to play with him in Ibiza over the years. He is a great teacher. Giles Peterson. Carl is the master when it comes to commandeering a dance floor. I have so much respect for that guy. Deadmau5. Carl's name is synonymous with dance and club culture. He is a founding father, icon, and legend who remains as committed, joyful, and passionate today as when I met him running sound systems in the 1980s. This book will further stamp his legacy in the history books and no doubt provide inspiration for future generations. Pete Tong, MBE. Already in the 1990s, when I was a hip-hop kid, I heard of Carl Cox. I met him years later in 2003 in Ibiza on the legendary Circo Loco Space Terrace. From that day, Carl and I are friends. We became a tag team at Space Closing for almost 4 years, and it was a team play that I enjoyed the most. Proper old-school vinyl competition. Carl would play a record, and I'd try to find something equally good, better, weirder. You play this? Ah, okay. Wait until you hear this one. Carl Cox is the daddy of all electronic music. His love, knowledge, and passion are contagious, and he motivates us all, shows us that even a daddy can kick your ass and stay on top in times of social media and short attention span of many people. Everybody loves Carl, and I am happy that I can call him family. Loco Dice. Carl is the most open-minded DJ. Musically, he is a trendsetter and doesn't follow in anyone's footsteps. His passion extends to the people around him. He always wants his friends and fellow DJs to get the best out of every situation. He'd have us all staying at the villa in Ibiza, so by the time we came to the club, we were part of his family and could focus on the music. He always thinks of the night as a whole rather than just focuses on his set like so many of the big artists. You couldn't ask for a better friend. I was in Australia on tour and met up with Carl and told him I wanted to see a kangaroo. No problem, he says. He drove me out to where there would be wild kangaroos and waited for an hour until one came along. Always thinking of others. That's Carl for you. Big heart, big sound, and big smile. Monica Cruz. An event with Carl Cox is a guaranteed roadblock, and his consistency behind the decks means he turns up every time and smashes it with his unmatched stage presence and positivity that just spreads through the crowd, whipping them into a frenzy night after night. He's a joy to watch and a joy to be around. John Digweed. I've known Carl Cox for many years, and we've experienced many great events together. Carl's a great DJ, one of the best in history. He knows how to connect with the crowd. He's a great person with a great personality and is a bunch of fun. Kevin Saunderson. I first met Carl back in 1987 when he was supplying a sound system for an Essex warehouse party. I couldn't have imagined that we'd go on to be on the same lineups at parties and festivals all over the world. He's a great friend, a true gent, and a huge inspiration to everyone. He's a true master of his craft and a wonderful human being. I love him for it. Darren Emerson. Working closely with Carl in the studio over the years has taught me a lot about being decisive, positive, and creative as he embraces new technology and ideas enthusiastically. As a producer, Carl is open and intuitive, and his ear for tuning, EQ, and timing is spot on. He never stops searching for the perfect beat. He has an irrepressible attitude of positivity at all times. Once he gave me a simple piece of advice when going out live. Enjoy yourself and smile a lot. This sums him up as an artist and as a friend. Whenever he walks on stage, the crowd just lifts because of his big smile, his generosity, and all-enveloping warmth. Christopher Coe. The thing I admire most in Carl, besides his love for music, beyond any reasonable doubt, is his versatility. It's captivating, especially when you can draw from all languages or musical styles and you choose to create your own. Then you know that you really are great. But that's what it means to be Carl Cox. Deborah DeLuca. I remember walking behind Carl, going into an outside daytime rave in Scotland in the early 1990s. For some reason, we were walking past a huge lineup of ravers trying to get into the party, and suddenly, people spotted Carl. Events were not so organized back then, and everyone started cheering and chanting, "Coxie, Coxie, Coxie." I had never witnessed the superstar DJ phenomenon at that point. Actually, it didn't really exist still at that point. But there it was in front of me. The roar of the crowd was thundering. People loved him, and Carl took it just like he would today, in his stride, smiling, waving, and high-fiving his fans as he walked by. Carl's love of music and his fans and his humility paved the way for his success and is something that all aspiring DJs can learn from. Richie Horton. Carl's always been such an inspiration to me. From the early rave days, being the original three-deck master, to watching him totally smash down Space Ibiza time after time, to seeing him play a drum and bass set on tour in Australia and then DJ all night to all the touring crew just for the fun of it. His talent, energy, and passion for making people dance is untouchable. I've been lucky enough to be invited to play with Carl, including in Ibiza, for which I'm eternally grateful. Feeling the vibe and anticipation as he stepped into the booth was something to behold, truly special. His Cabin Fever sets just show the pure passion and dedication of the man to his music and his craft. No stone has been left unturned, a testament to his vibe that good music is good music no matter what the style. To say this man loves his music is an understatement. I love this guy, and it's always an absolute pleasure to bump into him around the world for a catch-up and to get his advice. Plus, I get to see him smash it up again and again. Andy C. The legend that is Carl Cox, a super-talented DJ with mad technical skills. Always humble, he's a beautiful human being who's loved and respected worldwide. Carl's love and passion for music always shines through. I have some lovely, fun memories of Carl from back in the day, and whenever I see him, there's always a warm hug. He's a class act who's brought joy to dance floors for years and continues to do so. Big love. Nancy Noyes. Alon, Shulman, London, 2021. Welcome. When I was a boy, I cut someone's hedge and afterwards went to get paid the £1 we'd agreed. The guy didn't think I'd done a good enough job and refused to pay me. I'd been outside in the cold and rain for the best part of an hour, and he'd been watching me through the window. He waited until I'd finished and tidied up before telling me he wasn't happy. I argued with him, and his final reply before slamming the door on me was, "Save it for your book, sonny." Well, here's the book. Say hello to karma from me. I've thought about telling my story for quite a while, but the timing never seemed right. I wanted to be able to do it my way rather than it just be a list of dates and gigs with the odd DJ story. I wanted to share some of the behind-the-scenes stuff that people don't normally get to know and, through the stories, show what makes me tick. I wanted everyone to see what Carl Cox is all about. My working life is a tale of ups and downs. I went from a supermarket shelf stacker and scaffolder to a budding DJ living out of the back of a car. I made a big decision to provide sound systems to my friends, and then, just when it looked like things were going to work out, it seemed like everyone started running clubs that already had sound systems, and I was literally out in the cold. The unlicensed rave scene was my saviour, and although I spent a lot of time being chased around the countryside, I was finally able to express myself through my music. But even then, I never imagined that I would go on to become a successful DJ and artist, own a motorsports team, become the most listened to DJ on the planet, win awards, headline festivals all over the world, and that in 2021, I'd be bigger and more popular than ever before. Dance music is now the soundtrack to everything we do. It is the soundtrack of now and of tomorrow. I can't believe how far I've come and how far I think I can go. Despite all the success, and whether I'm behind the decks or in front of them, I am still very much the same Carl Cox I always was, still driven by my love of music and my desire to share it with everyone everywhere. I'm one of the crowd, and I just love being part of what's going on. I can't see that ever changing. And why would I want it to? Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Carl Cox, Melbourne, 2021. Chapter 1. Oh no, oh no. It's Sunday, 4th November 2007, and I'm on a flight to Barbados to see my parents. They're not expecting me, and I wasn't planning on going there, but my dreams are shattered, and I don't know what to do. I'm running away. I've decided to quit performing, to walk away from the thing I love the most. I need to get away from dance music and be with the people who don't see me as a DJ. I need to be with Mum and Dad. Overnight, I've decided to change back from DJ Carl Cox to plain old Carl. My tour manager, Ian Hussey, is in the seat next to me. He's looking exhausted, and he never looks exhausted. The last 24 hours have taken their toll. I've just told him that we need to cancel my South American tour, which is already underway, and he's had to relay this news to my management team so they can hit the phones to the promoters in their various countries first thing Monday. I know everyone is going to try to talk me out of this when I land, but it feels like a blanket has been thrown over the fire that music ignites in me. I've grabbed a one-way ticket from Venezuela to Barbados. I'm going under the radar. I just want to escape before the shit hits the fan. 2 days earlier, my head was in a totally different place. The weekend had started well. I'd arrived in Venezuela ready to take on South America. I'd been there a couple of years before, playing a VIP show in a hotel complex, and loved it. The people, the culture, the vibe, it all suited me perfectly, And now I was back to headline a festival and share my sound across a whole continent. It was exciting to be there. I'd met lots of Venezuelans at Space in Ibiza and promised that I would come over. The promoters wanted to show me the sights, but I was itching to get to the venue where I'd be playing the next day. It was Friday, and the festival was already underway when I arrived at Caracas's La Rinconda Terrace, where I was playing as part of the Red Noise Festival. It looked great, and they'd done a fantastic job on the sound system, which is always the first thing I look at. I'd heard the stories about Venezuela being a dangerous place, but all I could see was crowds of people coming together and dancing. Ian thought the security looked a bit young and inexperienced, just kids. But when we brought this up, we were told, "Don't worry, everything is cool." And I suppose we just went along with it. Saturday came, and like any big show day, I was starting to focus on the music, thinking about what I might play while getting into the local vibe as I walked around town. Fans were around me all day, thanking me for coming to Caracas, big smiles and totally up for it. I had dinner with a bunch of new friends before hitting the venue. It was all happy faces and laughter. Man, I was having fun. People eat late there, and after some grilled chicken, we headed over to the club for the main event. By the time I arrived, it was heaving. We came in through the back of the venue. There seemed to be a shortage of wristbands, but security just waved us all through. That should have been a sign. But at the time, I just thought that as an artist, I didn't need one. Ian went straight to the stage to double-check the setup, which was perfect. So far, so good. The party kicked off with fireworks, and the local support DJ came straight onto a packed dance floor. The club kept getting busier, and there were about 8,000 people going for it. Every time I came onto the stage to check out the crowd, I was met by a big cheer. Once again, techno had crossed cultural divides to bring us all together. I was playing a 3-hour set from midnight, and after a few more fireworks, I was on. The crowd erupted, and I was feeding off their energy, ready to go on a journey together. This was a party crowd, responding to every beat and mix as we got into our groove. Great lighting and smoke added to the atmosphere, and the promoters had worked hard to make this a special experience. I could hear a load of firecrackers going off, which is a bit distracting when you're perfecting your mix, and I made a mental note to make sure this didn't happen at the next gig. More firecrackers. And I looked up to see chunks of the crowd fleeing the dance floor. And then I heard the cheers turning to screams. More firecrackers. I've seen some crazy things from behind the decks and shared some serious emotions with the dance floor. But I didn't know what panic and fear looked like until that moment. I was still playing, and Ian was signalling to me while talking to the promoters, and then someone from behind me shouted in my ear, "They're shooting!" I was thinking, WTF, what do I do? Are they shooting at me? Who are they? And a million other things. All the while I kept playing as the dance floor emptied out. The DJ in me was overriding common sense. I couldn't just kill it, so I slowly drew down the crossfader, letting the track gently go silent. And in the same movement, I dropped down behind the decks. Without the music, the screams became deafening. I popped my head up, saw bodies on the ground and pandemonium, and dropped right back down. The stage manager was screaming at us, "Venga conmigo! Venga conmigo! Come with me! Come with me! Come!" Next thing, I was crawling on my hands and knees, following Ian as we got off the stage. Then we were up and running. We reached a locker room by the backstage toilets and barricaded ourselves in, pulling a security guard in with us. At this point, I didn't know what was happening or if the gunman was still around and if they were after me. A few minutes later, we heard more shots and then silence. Finally, there was a knock on the door, but we weren't opening it for anyone. The promoter shouted through that he was leaving a security guy outside the door and that the police were on their way. We had our car brought round the back and, still not knowing what the hell was going on, decided to make a break for it. Ian always goes above and beyond and somehow convinced the police to escort him back up to the stage to pick up the kit. I was having none of it. I just wanted to get as far away as possible. Then, surrounded by police and security, we made our way into the car and back to the hotel. By now, it was nearly 3 a.m. and we were starting to find out what had happened. It turned out a local gang member was a fan, and with one of his men and both their wives, they came to the club to hear me play. As the story goes, the word got out to a rival gang who turned up, bypassed the security, sought them out, and killed them. With so much security present, I was amazed that something like this could happen. Four people shot dead less than 15 meters in front of me, with another 9 people wounded in the crossfire. I could never, in my worst nightmares, have imagined such an atrocity could happen on a dance floor. I've seen all manner of things, but this was dark. Then the phones started to ring. News services were beginning to run with a story, 4 killed at Carl Cox event, and the Chinese whispers meant friends were getting calls saying I'd been killed. To add to the craziness of the situation, the guy on the stage filming the gig had captured the whole thing, including the bodies on the dance floor, me ducking below the decks, and the aftermath. People were starting to see it online, and I could only imagine how chilling it was to see bodies lying dead on the dance floor where moments earlier they'd been celebrating life. It's now all over the internet, but I still can't bring myself to watch it. Of course, I was oblivious to this. I just wanted to get the fuck out of Dodge. By the time the press found out where I was staying, I was already in the air, on the way to Barbados. Barbados is a magical island. Everyone that goes there, even for a short visit, feels the specialness of the place. By 2007, my parents had long since moved back there from the UK, which was perfect for them. Both very unwell, they were surrounded by friends and family. My mum was especially proud of my achievements. I'd made a success of myself, kept out of trouble, for the most part, put a few quid in my pocket with a bit aside for a rainy day, and they could see how happy my music was making me. This visit was different. I was different. I'll be talking about my folks later on in the book, but for now, you can imagine how painful this trip was. My dad was already so affected by his Alzheimer's that he wouldn't have known what was going on, and my mum was very sick too. I didn't realize how short a time she was to have left. And I've always felt some peace in the knowledge that she saw how I turned to her in my darkest moment. I'll come back to my folks later, because it's important to me that the first time you meet my parents is how I want you to remember them, happy and full of life. My team and I are a close-knit family, and after the shootings, we had spoken about the tour and the wider picture. I felt it was time for me to step back. If this was where dance music was going, then maybe hanging up my headphones was a wise move. I wasn't thinking straight after what had happened. I guess looking at it now and seeing how it still affects me, I was still probably in shock, but I was sure that it was game over. Ian has since told me that when I got on the plane, I said I was 200% never going back, and when we landed a few hours later, I was still 100% sure of that. Lynn Cosgrave at Safe House had put together the tour alongside my booking agent Ian Hindmarsh. He'd vetted the venues and promoters and done everything humanly possible to help me bring my sound to South America. He was in the front line, and you might expect that he'd push me to get back on the horse. But he knows me really well and could see that I just needed friends around me and no extra pressure. At this point, I still wasn't certain if the shooting had been directed at me or not. We agreed that I'd spend a week thinking about what to do and that the tour wouldn't be cancelled but put on hold. Looking back, I was probably at 50-50 by this point. Today, we understand a lot more about emotional trauma and how long the recovery process can be, but back then, 7 days seemed like a long time. I hadn't been physically injured, and a week seemed like a luxury. What I do is not a typical job. Music is my passion, and sharing it has always been my focus. DJs don't go to work, they go to play. And when something is such a big part of your DNA, it is almost impossible to live without it. For sure, this was some other dimension crazy shit, but I'd worked too hard from a standing start to get to where I was to let a bunch of cold-blooded murderers take that away from me. Pretty soon, I felt there was a 90% chance that I was back. In fact, I felt like I hadn't been away at all. In my hardest times, it has always been the music that kept me going and made me happy. I remember making the phone call to Ian. I looked in the mirror as I dialed and said to myself, I'm Carl Cox. I'm a DJ, the people's choice, the three-deck wizard. I love music and nothing will stop me from making it. It was a short conversation. Ian had second-guessed me, spoken to all the promoters, and had put extra arrangements in place. It wasn't quite playing behind bulletproof glass, which had been discussed and dismissed by me, but he'd arranged extra security at all the gigs so I was protected from the airport to the car to the hotel to the gig and back again. Looking back, it seems like overkill. But back then, without that, I wouldn't have been able to focus on the music. I found out a couple of years later that Ian had also pre-written the cancellation emails as he wasn't sure which way I was going to go. The Caracas gig had done me in mentally and had nearly finished my career. In fact, as yet, I haven't been back to Venezuela since the shooting, and that's something I need to change. I did a lot of soul-searching during that week in Barbados. Maybe I'd achieved everything possible. Maybe it was a sign or a lucky escape. But quickly, I started thinking about new ideas and concepts. When you're on the go all day long and every day, you don't have time to take stock. That is what I did in Barbados. Performing, producing, collaborating, remixing, creating, music runs to my very soul. There was only one way for me to go, and that is the way I always go, forwards. I came back from the brink super energized with a plan and a clear vision of the direction I wanted to go in. And people all over the world have loved sharing the energy with me ever since. I still can't quite believe how close I came to calling it a day. So it was bye-bye Barbados and hello again South America. I was back, but not my usual self. I felt nervous being there, guilty that I'd run from Venezuela in the first place and worried that something would go down again. Dance music had come a long way from the underground rave scene and I felt responsible that everyone would look at me as an ambassador of the industry. The first gig was very scary. I kept sneaking a peek from backstage to the capacity crowd and trying to see if I could spot any trouble. One sign and I'll be off for sure, I kept thinking. I knew the crowd were all aware of what had happened. Maybe shootouts were part of the culture. Maybe they weren't ready to let themselves go deep into the music. Lots of maybes. Don't bottle it, Coxie. As I stepped up onto the stage, I felt very exposed. It was like slow motion, and suddenly it hit me. They were here for me, and I was here for them. I stood in front of them, and the whole crowd started clapping louder than the music. They weren't just clapping me. They were clapping the whole scene. And with that, I launched myself into one of the best sets I've ever played. I tried to act solemn and serious, but I could feel my face break into a massive smile as I felt that connection. Boom! Oh yes! Oh yes! I was definitely back. Chapter 2. Here I am. People always think that I was born in Brighton, but there's something you probably don't know. I'm actually a northerner. Carl Andrew Cox was born in Oldham, near Manchester, in July 1962, and was only transported down south at the age of 6 months, so I guess that makes me an honorary northerner. First stop was Tooting Broadway, which was a bustly kind of place and where I lived until I was 4 or 5, before we moved 5 miles down the road to Carshalton. My parents came from Barbados, and like many West Indians of their generation, they came to England to work. My father Henry, or to give him his full name, Henry Carlisle Cox, known as Carl Sr., worked on the buses. Merton Bus Depot was his second home. My mother, Patricia, was a nurse and midwife at St. George's Hospital in Tooting. My parents worked really hard to give us a good home. And by us, I mean me and my two younger sisters, Andrea and Pamela. We had some cousins from my mum's side living in Harlow and saw them a lot. But apart from these visits, we were the only black family in our area. And that came with its own problems. But problems are only problems if you let them become so. My first memories revolve around music. My parents had come over from the Caribbean determined to make the best of things. And even though I can see now that things can't have been easy for them, they made a happy home. My sisters and myself enjoyed the best soul music as it drifted through the house. Dad's record player was meant to be out of bounds. But after hearing the likes of Aretha Franklin, Booker T and the MGs, and Elvis Presley, I was always trying to play his records, and he'd usually turn a blind eye. I didn't realize at the time how much we had bonded through his music, and I only became aware of this when I played his original records on a special virtual show in 2020. I'll come back to that later. Mum and Dad had a great collection of soul 45s, and I would love choosing the right single for the mood in the house and get excited when a family member started to bop around the lounge. It wasn't long before I was working out what to play and in what order to keep the family dancing. I never imagined that you could get a job playing records, but I knew that I loved doing it, and I particularly loved the feeling of making the right selection. My folks started me off on the path that has led me to where I am today. With all the crazy things kids get up to, my parents were probably relieved that I was spending any money I had on records and not getting myself into trouble. That's not to say that there weren't times when I pushed the envelope a bit too far. Even from a young age, I loved bikes. And when I was 7 or 8, I had a golden arrow bicycle, which I was really proud of. One day, I rode off and ended up cycling from Carshalton all the way to Croydon before the police stopped me, realized I was a long way from home, and drove me back in their panda car. My mum looked shocked when the police knocked on the door and saw me sitting in the back, smiling away. My sisters were very jealous that I'd been in a police car. Luckily, my dad was at work at the time, although he might have seen the funny side. We did cause a major parental explosion another time when Pamela was cooking sausages for our tea when she was 14. She'd left them under the grill and forgotten about them. I was up in my room when I heard a shriek and ran down. The oil had caught fire and the kitchen was filled with black smoke. So I grabbed the pan and carried it out to the front garden, amazingly without getting any of the boiling oil on my legs, although I did slosh it all over the brand new carpet. By the time my parents came back from work, Andrea and Pamela had run off and hidden, and my folks came into a smoke-filled house, burnt and blackened wallpaper and a stained carpet. All three of us caught it big time. My mum, God rest her soul, was a great cook, and our house always had that homely smell of West Indian cooking. She made a good chicken, rice and peas, but my favourite was the macaroni pie done in the true West Indian style using sweet potato. I think that the food helped them stay connected to the friends and family they had left behind. My parents really wanted me to focus at school, but try as I might, studying really wasn't for me. I did enjoy going to school, but as I got older, it seemed a big part of the day to be away from the music I loved, so I did the obvious thing. Well, actually, the obvious thing would have been to cut school, so I ended up doing the second most obvious thing. I took the music to the school. I had a small turntable with a built-in amp and would spend break time and lunchtime spinning a few tunes. These were mostly my dad's records, so lots of soul. The other kids seemed to enjoy it, and I would watch and see which tunes had the best reactions and mentally file them away as guaranteed floor fillers. By the age of 10, I was a full-on vinyl junkie and was spending every bit of my pocket money on funk and soul records. The great thing about living in Carshalton was that people seemed happy to dump their records at the local charity shop, and you could pick up some great calypso, soul, and jazz if you knew where to look. Racism played a big part in my school experience. Kids can be cruel, even if they don't mean to be. But some of these kids really did mean to be cruel. I tried not to let it bother me, but I did think how unfair it was. Being black has never defined me. Most of my friends, like me, don't see colour or religion, but the person. The bullies soon left me alone, not because I grew to be bigger than all of them, but because I genuinely wasn't bothered. Karma has a funny way of surfacing when you least expect it to. I remember being in a club and coming down at about 3 a.m. for some air. There was still a massive queue outside. I was pretty well known by now, and people in the queue would reach out to shake my hand. There was a group of guys and girls shivering outside, waiting their turn, and one guy called me over. Carl! Carl! I recognized him as someone who'd given me grief many years before. I walked over, a big smile on my face as usual. He looked at me and said, "We were at school together." I looked back at him and said, "Good for you, mate," and walked off. Funnily enough, even though all his friends got into the club, for some reason the doormen kept turning him away. My favorite record as a kid was Metal Guru by Mark Bolan and T-Rex. I didn't know what the lyrics meant, but I loved the music and the energy. It didn't really fit with the music we had.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.